particularly school students. It's indeed a great honor for the Nehru Science Center to be hosting this extraordinary lecture, the Raman Memorial Lecture by Professor Mashelkar sir. Everyone knows who Professor Mashelkar sir is. No introduction is necessary, but even then my colleague Umesh will be giving a brief about Professor Mashelkar sir. But then I'm just going to be telling you about what the significance of this science, National Science Day has been. And we at the Nehru Science Center have been commemorating this National Science Day since its inception in 1987. And the key point are on the 28th February, on the National Science Day, it culminates with what we call as a Raman Memorial Lecture. We have had the best of scientists. In fact, Professor Mashelkar sir has already spoken once. This is the second time that he's going to be speaking. We've had CNR Rao sahab, Professor CNR Rao. We had Dr. Abdul Kalam, M.M. Sharma, Dr. Kakodkar, everyone, every who's who. But there is a difference this year. The difference is all the Raman Memorial Lecture is to be held at the auditorium of the Nehru Science Center. In the new norm of the COVID era, this is for the first time that we are having this online. There are some flip side benefits also, spin-off benefits in the sense this lecture is going to be streamed live on Facebook and YouTube. And so it is going to be there. The lecture is going to be there for posterity. And the topic is so beautifully framed, making science work for the poor. From a personal lens. I'm not going to be standing between our audience and our respected Mashelkar sir. May I now request Umesh Kumar, my colleague, to please introduce Professor Mashelkar sir, and then we'll hand over the mic to Professor Mashelkar sir. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir. As sir has already told that Dr. Mashelkar doesn't need any introduction, but I think it's a privilege and honor for me to introduce Dr. Mashelkar and to be in the frame with him. Dr. Mashelkar, a National Research Professor, has been the Director General of Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, CSIR, Chairman of National Innovation Foundation, as also the President of Indian National Science Academy, Global Research Alliance, and Institute of Chemical Engineers in United Kingdom. In recognition of his pioneering research contributions in polymer science and engineering, he has been honored as a Fellow of Royal Society, Foreign Fellow of US National Academy of Science, as also engineering, Foreign Associate of American Academy of Arts and Science, and Fellow of US National Academy of Inventors. 44 universities from around the world have honored him with honorary doctorates. The 60 plus awards won by him include the prestigious TWS Lenovo Science Prize, Business Week USA Award of Stars of Asia, and JRD Tata Corporate Leadership Award. Dr. Mashelkar was a member of the Scientific Advisory Council to the Prime Minister of over 30 years, has been honored with Padam Shri, Padam Bhushan, and Padam Vibhushan, three of the highest civilian honors. In fact, I would like to just add one line that he has been a guiding force for National Council of Science Museums as well, of which Nehru Science Center is a part in the governing body member. And he has always been with us for guiding us in taking masses to the millions. With this brief introduction, I'll request Dr. Mashelkar, sir, please take over and start your presentation.
Thank you. Thank you very much. My very warm greetings to you all on this great day, the Science Day. In fact, to me, every day is a Science Day, but this day we especially remember because of its connection with the Nobel Prize winning work of Sir C.V. Raman. I'm also very happy, Shiv Prasad Ji, Umesh, that although digitally I'm connecting with Nehru Science Center, this has been my favorite. Yes, as you rightly said, I've been very closely associated with Nehru Science Center as a part of the governing body and in various activities. So it's wonderful to be again connected with you. Let me begin my talk by simply saying that if you look at the need of the hour today, it is the title of this lecture, Making Science Work for the Poor. And this, as I say, is going to be a view from a personal lens, because what you will find is not what you see from the books behind me that you see in the background, but it is all about what I have experienced from my laboratory of life, my journey in my life. So it's a very personal view, I would say. Now, what is the inspiration for today's Science Day lecture? It is actually Mahatma Gandhi's thought that has given me this timeless inspiration. Among many things that he had said, one of the things that he said was, I would prize every invention of science made for the benefit for all, benefit for the poor, poorest of the poor. Now, this becomes very important. I mean, in today's context, for example, it was always important. If you just see the challenge of pandemic, the inequalities have suddenly amplified. You know, we're reducing poverty. For example, 2018, we reduced poverty by 1.2%, 2019 by 1.5%. But suddenly you find 2020 a disaster and years of progress has gone in days. As you can quite clearly see, this was the kind of reduction that we're having. And these are the April projection, June downside projection, and so on. And 2020, the people who have been thrown from poverty to extreme poverty, you know, you can see the number here, -7.1%. And what the World Bank says is that it could, COVID-19 could push 100 million people into extreme poverty. This was an old prediction, but yesterday we had the Pune International Center, External Affairs Ministry, Asia Economic Dialogue. And there, once again, the World Bank representative repeated this figure of 100 million people. Now, please understand what is extreme poverty, like these children who are eating on the street, and some of them may not be able to even eat. I think that is the issue. And therefore, I think we have to really worry about what difference we can make. And therefore, this I would prize every invention of science made for the benefit for all, means for more and more and more people. I would add something else to that. Because Mahatma Gandhi had not only said this, but he had also said that earth provides enough to satisfy every man's need, but not for every man's greed. What does that mean? It means preserve your resources, particularly the exhaustible resources, non-renewable resources, get more from them, and get more from less, be more efficient in terms of using those resources so that you can preserve them for the needy, the poor, the future generations, your great grandchildren, their great grandchildren, and so on. So if I combine these more from less for more, that becomes an interesting suggestion on what I might like to call as a Gandhian engineering, that is getting more performance from less resource for more people, okay? Now, this term Gandhian engineering, I coined MLM as it is called, when I was honored with the Australian Academy Fellowship, and you can see Professor Robin Batterham, the president of the Academy here, and my giving a talk, and the title of the talk was Gandhian Engineering, More from Less for More. And this I gave 20th April 2008, and that was the first time this term was coined, Gandhian Engineering, More from Less for More. Now, making this is actually getting more from less for more. He's almost saying that despite income inequality, you have to ensure access equality. Now, you say, how can that be? How can rich and poor be equal? How can they have the same things? And so on and so forth. But we have proved them wrong. We have shown that it can happen. For example, look at this lady from the slum, and look at this very sophisticated lady. What is the income inequality? 1,000:1. But what is the access equality? 1:1. Both of them are having their mobiles. Okay? So how can we do this miracle, what we did in this, in terms of education, in terms of health, in terms of whatever other offerings that we have? Now, the access becomes so important, and we start with education. Education is fundamental. Look at this lady. Okay, look at the poverty that they have. This is their home. And this girl is actually, the mother is helping her with the uniform because she believes in something very important. And what is that? And that is that the future, her future will depend upon education. And I remember, actually, this was several years ago, there was a discussion that was going on in terms of equations. What are the basic equations? And the Science Day is a good day to discuss about it. So somebody said, of course, Newton's law, force equal to mass into acceleration. All right. Somebody said, no. It is not force equal to mass into acceleration. It is Einstein, E equal to mc square. And I was sitting quiet. Then somebody came to me and said, you are not saying anything. I said, no, not Newton's law, not Einstein. It is E equal to F. And they wondered what E is equal to F was. So I said, E equal to F is education equal to future. E is education and F is future. And how do you get access to education despite inequality will decide everything. Now you would say you are a scientist, a good scientist, because you start your lectures with an equation, but the good scientist also gives the proof of that equation. So please give us the proof of this equation. The very fact that I'm talking to you is the proof of this equation, and I will tell you why. You can see this next photograph. What is this photograph? You know, K.R. Narayanan, who was then the president, is honoring me with Padma Bhushan. And on the same day, one after the other, K.R. Narayanan is honoring Ratan Tata with the Padma Bhushan. Both on the same day, one after the other. Now you would say, come on, don't tell me that this proves E equal to F. But I will tell you why. K.R. Narayanan was born in a very poor family. He used to walk several kilometers to go to school. His poverty was such that his parents could not afford tuition fee. So he would stand outside the class and take notes. As far as I was concerned, I was also born in extreme poverty. I was born in a village called Mashel. My father died when I was 6, and my mother, the widowed mother, and I was the only son, she brought me to Mumbai. And she started doing some menial work to bring me up. 2 meals a day was a challenge for me. I was barefoot until I was 12. I studied under street lights. So they were extremely difficult times. Okay. And I was about to leave my education after I did my SSC in the Maharashtra board. I had stood 11th among 135,000 students. You know, but still I was going to leave it because I couldn't bear my mother doing what she was doing. And Tatas came and gave me a scholarship. So here is K.R. Narayanan. He became the president of India because he got a Tata scholarship and he could study. I rose to whatever I was because of a Tata scholarship. Now here you can see the paradox. The paradox is an individual who could study because of Tata scholarship is honoring the head of Tatas with Padma Bhushan. Is it not the proof of E equal to F? So access to education is extremely important. But what has pandemic done? Pandemic, at that time, Raghunath Mashelkar could get 60 rupees per month and that was enough for him. He could study. Not today. Today what has happened is that 1.6 billion children went out of the school in 100 days. And one third of and online learning became the key. But one third of them don't have access to either devices or networks or connectivity and so on and so forth. That means that access to education now is going to depend. If you are digitally deprived, you'll be deprived in terms of education also. And its consequences you can see, disastrous consequence. Assam, with no smartphone, 15-year-old student commits suicide after failing to attend online classes. This was June 23rd, by the way. During the pandemic, how pathetic it is. And this is something that is happening, had happened around the country. Like in Punjab, a class 11 student. In Assam, a 15-year-old student. In Maharashtra, a 15-year-old girl student. West Bengal, class 10 student. Kerala, 16-year-old student. Karnataka, 15-year-old student. And therefore, what happens is that the digital access becomes a necessity. Just like we say roti kapda makan, you know, access to internet becomes equally important. And therefore, I remember I was invited by the UNESCO Director General in July to join a panel discussion of presidents of different universities. So we had MIT president, Tsinghua from China, Tokyo, and so on. And I remember at that time, I said, if there is a lack of digital access, then we are going to have a challenge in terms of no access to education. And I remember at that time, Jeffrey Sachs saying that we have 17, let us say, sustainable development goals. We should have the 18th one, which should be universal digital access. That is how critical it is. Now, can we do that? In fact, India had produced Akash, $35 tablet, okay, in 2010, you can see him launching. And that should have been in the hands of the children. And in 2010, if it was in the hands of the children, today, those suicides would not have taken place because that $35 would have been $5 or $10 today. Similarly, I remember when I was the DG of CSIR, I had launched a program where we talked about Mobilis, a $200 laptop, you know, not $2,000 laptop. And I remember we had a challenge, in terms of having it, but not getting it to the people. Similarly, Simputer, for example, this was created in 2001. And Bruce Sterling from New York Times had said that this is the most significant innovation in computer technology in 2001 was not Apple's gleaming titanium PowerBook G4 or Microsoft Windows XP. It was the Simputer, a NetLink, radically simple portable computer. Where is it now? If it was available today, no suicides would have taken place. I think the main point I'm trying to make is that when we say Gandhian engineering, getting more from less for poor, making science work for the poor, Indian innovation had actually done it, but unfortunately, it did not find get into the marketplace. So I think what is important to recognize is that there is this golden triangle, that there is this society. We create a technology for the society, but the government policy matters. And in fact, what we require is a bold and innovative public procurement policy for and of innovation. Or in other words, when the Simputer was created, supposing the government had put an order for 10,000, he would have got the initial order, okay, the Simputer team, and then they would have worked on that product, and then basically you would have had a chance to get a market feedback, improve it, and that 10,000 would have been 100,000, and then 10 lakh, and a million, and so on, and today we would have been selling millions of Simputers. So I have actually written about this. There is this brilliant book, The Path Ahead, Anthology of Transformative Ideas for India, which is created by Amitabh Kant, CEO of Niti Aayog. And this is titled as Innovative Public Procurement Policy for Fueling Assured Inclusive Innovation. And I think we desperately need those. And I'm very happy to see that the present government, with its startup policy and encouraging startups, is creating a positive public procurement policy for fueling such innovations. More from less for more, I think India has become an expert in this, by the way. And the important part is, for example, high quality hepatitis B vaccine, 40 times cheaper, not 40%. High quality cataract eye surgery, 100 times cheaper, not 100%. High quality open heart surgery, 20 times cheaper, not 20%. High quality artificial food, 300 times cheaper, not 300%. So this more from less for more comes very naturally to us, because many people call it frugal innovation, many people call it inclusive innovation, we call it Gandhian engineering, we call it more from less for more, they all mean the same, okay? Work making science work for the benefit of the poor, because if it is 40 times cheaper, 100 times cheaper, then the poor can afford it. So it is all about creating affordable excellence, because remember the word high quality, okay? It is not low quality, it is high quality. Now, this is, as I said, very proudly, no dreams, India has done it. That is science working for the poor. Now, Gandhian engineering, that MLM mantra, started spreading around the world. You remember I talked in 2008. Then C.K. Prahlad, the great thought leader of India, he and I wrote a paper in Harvard Business Review. It was titled as Innovation's Holy Grail, More from Less for More. And you can see that it found place in the 10 must read papers in innovation because it was extremely appealing to the people. Because today when we talk about inequalities, how do you take care of inequalities? And to such an extent, the world was inspired that in World Economic Forum, they had a special session, More from Less for More, within 6 months of this paper appearing. And then I gave a TED talk, which you can see has been now available in 23 languages around the world on the same subject. So the word started spreading. And here is something very interesting. You know, once I'm possessed by an idea, I just don't leave it. I began in Canberra, Melbourne in 2008. And then I was invited in the US and in Washington in particular, in World Bank in particular. And I remember talking about this and they creating in Vietnam an inclusive innovation project. It was a $55 million project. I spoke in New York, Boston, Atlanta, spreading the message there. Then I remember Manila, I had this lecture at the Asian Development Bank. And they started a program on More from Less for More, inclusive innovation. Then I remember talking in Europe, in Brussels in particular, where the European Commissioner had invited me to speak. I spoke to some 2,000 Europeans. And believe me or not, they included this in their 2020 program as frugal innovation being critical for access and removing inequality. I was invited to Beijing. Normally China is so much ahead of us, but they respect what we have done in terms of frugal innovation. And they wanted to learn from us. And I remember a major conference. I had gone there as a World Bank consultant, but they held that. And you know the reason they held that? Because they said that the inequalities will create human challenge in terms of disharmony. And therefore, we must have this access equality despite income inequality. I spoke at a number of places. I kept on getting invited. I didn't say no to any invitation. Last year, I spoke in Tokyo, in Colombo, in South Africa, in Medellin. There was this WITRO conference and so on and so forth. I think the central point is that I spread the message sort of all around from 2008 till today. But they will say, you are spreading the message. What is it that you are doing yourself? Well, my own CSR, I'm very proud to say, follows this mantra of more from less for more. Today, if there are affordable drugs, it is because of CSR, the work that they have done. All right. For example, HIV/AIDS was $10,000 for a year's treatment. It was the chemistry that was done in Institute of Chemical Technology by Dr. Gurjar, which brought that $10,000 down to $300. It was almost a dollar per day. Cipla worked closely with IICT and so on and so forth. So CSR is doing it. But you know, each one of us must do something on our own. So that's why I said from my personal lens. And this is where I started. Anjali Mashelkar was my mother, and she left us for her heavenly abode on 17 November 2006. And I remember, you know, I had this habit of, although I was DG of CSIR in Delhi, I used to come every weekend and spend time in my lab, Saturday, Sunday. Sunday night, I would go. And my practice was that whatever little money I would have in my pocket, I would give it to my mother. Whatever, 200 rupees, 500 rupees, 1,000 rupees, whatever. We never asked her what she did with it. She had kept it all. And my daughter Shruti, when she was organizing her saris, basically after she passed away, she found all that money was kept there. And she had left me the same message that Mahatma Gandhi had used this little money for doing some science for the poor. And I remember those years I had got two big awards. I put that money plus my own money and created this 1 lakh rupees per year Anjani Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Award from the interest. Now, this was powered by Gandhian Engineering and her thought. And the key points are affordability, accessibility, and adaptability. Now, I'll give you some examples from a personal lens on how we made science work for the poor. Here, you see Shyam Vasudeva getting his award, Trinitra. And Narayan Murthy, you can see in the background, was the chief guest for the first award function. And what he did was that he created a portable, non-invasive, non-myriatic, low-cost device for detecting 5 eye diseases. Because the challenge was that 90% of eye care equipment were not affordable to hospitals in India. They were imported, not portable, and needed a lot of power and expertise. So he made it 6 times cheaper. Now, in 25 countries, there are 4,000 devices that are operational, and it has already screened 5 million people. This is making science work for the poor. The other awardee, you can see Anu Aga here in the background giving this award to Mishkin Ingawale, and he created TouchHB. What was this? Now, hemoglobin, for example, test if you have to do, you will take 100, 150, 200 rupees, depending upon where you go. He created a 10 rupee one. And he was ahead of the best practice. He created the next practice. What was the best practice? It was invasive with needles, right? The next practice was non-invasive, no needles. The cost per test was 150 rupees. He created one for just 10 rupees. And it was needle-free and painless because you just put it around your finger. So TouchHB 1.0 was like this, but he went on doing something further. And the most important part I want to mention to you is that he used high technology, okay? Because making high technology work for the rich is very easy. Making low technology work for the poor is very easy. But making high technology work for the poor is very difficult. And that's what he did. If you see, he used photoplethysmography, spectrophotometry, advanced software for photon scattering and so on. But he didn't stop at that. He created the second version, which captures the picture of conjunctiva and uses the method of reflective photometry to estimate hemoglobin content. And you don't, it's completely non-invasive, as you can see. You don't even touch your finger, okay? Then the next one is Rahul Rastogi for Sanket, the ECG device. And actually, I can show this device to you, what he did. His challenge was that his father had this heart issue, and therefore he had to actually take him to a hospital to take ECG and so on and so forth. And as you know, you go there, you lie down, and then you put leads, and then ECG is taken. And takes 30 minutes and a lot of money. He said, why? Why can't I create something which is portable? And that's what he did. You can see that. And that's his Sanket 1.0. That is what he had created. Okay. It was a personal 12-lead ECG event monitor, portable. You can go and buy it, by the way, on Amazon. You just put Sanket and you buy it for 2,500 rupees. And he has sold 0.2 million plus devices in 8 countries. This is very important, by the way. Our Prime Minister rightly said, make in India for the world. As you saw, Trinetra, make in India for the world, 25 countries. Sanket, make in India for the world, sold in 8 countries. And he has now created this Sanket 2.0, which I have in hand. It's a very, very simple device to operate. You put your 2 thumbs on the sensor for 15 seconds, and then this is your heart. You put it above the heart, 15, 15, 15 seconds, below the heart, 15, 15, 15 seconds. And within 3 minutes, if you have downloaded an app called Sanket, it reaches the best doctor. Now, what does that mean for India? Supposing there is a woman in village, okay, an old woman, she had heart pain and ECG had to be taken. You had to put her in a bullock cart and drive, take her to 10 kilometers or put her on a scooter or whatever, motorcycle. No more so. While sitting there, it's like using an advanced thermometer, you can take that ECG. This is making science work for the poor. The other one was this eye-braced exam of Mir Shah. This is just $1 breast cancer screening. And this is a low-cost tactile sensor that measures tissue stiffness difference in real time. It is ultra-portable, accurate, minimal training, wireless, cloud-connected, and you get instant results. And I'm very happy to say it is going to 25 countries now. You can quite clearly see he has partnered with GE Life Sciences. Again, made in India for the world. Okay. The other one is Naveen Khanna. He has created a dengue day one test. Normally, I hope none of you had dengue, but if you had, you will realize that it takes 1 or 2 days before you get the results. Here, you get the results in 15 minutes. And it has become a market leader. They have done 10 million dengue tests, and they are 25% of the conventional test, very, very accurate, and again, being sold all around the world. And Vinay Kumar, for example, 2018, he created 8 test results within 60 seconds, by the way, and 20% of the usual cost. And the point of care, biosensing, diabetes management, kidney failure, anemia, everything it can actually detect. Now, I come to something very important last year, 2019. We're celebrating 150 years of Mahatma, okay? And this award went to these young boys that you see. They're from engineering college from Kerala. It is called Gen Robotics. And what is that? That was something which was something very special to Gandhiji. He had said sanitation is more important than political freedom in 1947, and Supreme Court had said the sewers are gas chambers where manual scavengers are sent to die. And this was true. If you see, 4.5 million people engaged in manual scavenging, 22,000 men die in India during various kinds of sanitation work, you know, and they are diagnosed with fatal diseases. So man in the hole, manhole is itself a wrong term. I hate it. Because how can you have a man in the hole? You can have a machine in the hole. So that's what exactly they did. They created a robot which does the cleaning with a simple user interface. So what happens, this man in the hole that you see on your left becomes a robot operator. So this is the most important part. This is access to dignity. Supposing this manual scavenger, his children were asked in school, what does your father do? They would have put their head down and said manual scavenging. Now, that fellow is trained as a robot operator. He doesn't lose his job. So if the children are asked now, what does your father do? They will say, he's a robot operator. You can see this is societal transformation. And I'm very happy to see that after this has come out, the government has come out with a prohibition of employment as manual scavengers bill, where they've made it mandatory that you should use such mechanical solutions. So such technology can be absolutely transformative. Now, here is an interesting news that I saw, which is very pathetic, very sad. It says, and this is just 6 weeks ago, the situation here is dire. Every minute, 10 people test positive for COVID-19. Every 8 minutes, someone dies. Ambulance circle for hours, unable to find ERs that can accept patients. Hospitals are running out of oxygen. ICU capacity is at zero. Patients lie in hallways and tents. Emergency room nurses have more patients than they can handle, sometimes 6 at a time. Can you just imagine that? Normally, if I had not put the word Los Angeles here, you would have thought this is in some poor country, poor village in Africa, etc. Now look at here, what they are saying is that there is no ICU capacity. Now, you know, the 2020 Anjani Mashelkar Inclusive Innovation Awardee had the solution for US problem, because he has created something which does the job of an ICU. This is called DOSI. It's a continuous contact-free vitals monitor with remote monitoring capabilities, 20 times cheaper than the products used in ICU. Doesn't require maintenance, no consumables, no prior technical expertise, and you can have a care at home. And believe me, the accuracy of the 8 parameters that they measure is 98.4%. Can you just imagine what a difference it can make anywhere around the world? Now, finally, I want to say that you will say, oh, this is all happening around the world, and it is the big laboratories, etc., startups, etc., they're king. But I want to tell you that the students can become key participants in doing science for the poor. And I'm very happy that number of young students are listening to my lecture. I'll give you an example. In fact, what we need to do is to drive science and technology for inclusive society. We have to use Gandhian engineering to integrate it as a core of the educational and research experience. And I want to emphasize that Stanford is doing it, Harvard is doing it, MIT is doing it. Now you can't believe it, I'll show you an example. Take for example, this. The question is, why are 90% of the world's products and services designed for 10% of world's population? Okay. And Stanford University created this entrepreneurial design for extreme affordability program for undergraduate students. Huh? And this was a student competition for bottom of the pyramid grant challenges. There were 20 million premature babies that are born every year. And 450 of them die each hour. You know why? Because they have to be put in incubator and there are no incubators. Why? Because they're expensive, $2,000. Who can afford? And they created this Embrace, which is a $25 incubator by using phase transfer fluids, by the way, as you can see the baby. And what is the impact? You can quite clearly see that if a baby was born in a hospital, it had to be moved into the incubator, right? Okay. Now, you can't, because the baby is born not in a hospital, but in a hut. Then how do you move that baby into a hospital like that? Impossible, isn't it? Okay. So what you do is that you have this particular incubator. The baby doesn't go to the incubator. The incubator goes to the baby. Okay. And therefore, the child is saved. Okay. So that is the difference. Now, how can you make that? Because, you know, we all do high science, high technology, breakthroughs, this, that, and the other, etc. But what is now important is that there are new drivers, as you can see here. Because normally when you do frontier innovation, you will see it is curiosity or market-driven science research. Now, if you are doing science innovation for the poor, it has to be applications and impact-driven, cost-conscious science. The second is our normal frontier science is driven by sophisticated research capabilities, is popular among policymakers. But we have to do science and innovation for the poor. It is innovative entrepreneurs. They're faced with challenge of scarcity and aspiration and business vying for market. If you look at the market, there are well-established route from idea to product to market. Here, there are newer routes. If you look at margins, high science requires also a lot of money. So high R&D investments, how do you recover them? So you create costly products? No. These are high volume, low margin products and services. You know, like for example, why are our smartphones, the mobile so cheap? Because you sell 1 billion of them, all right? Not small. So small price, but high volume. And finally, the goals of the frontier innovation is always improving productivity, economic growth, and so on. No. Here, the emphasis is improving the lives of people, particularly the poor, and giving them purchasing power and social harmony. I must also end by saying that we have to do democratization of innovation. Everyone is someone. And to me, 1.25 billion Indians are not 1.25 billion mouths, but 1.25 billion minds. Every student who is listening to me can create an innovation. And minds on the margin are not marginal minds, as my guru, Professor Anil Gupta, the creator of grassroots innovation movement in India says. And you can quite clearly see, this is where our National Innovation Foundation, you can see Professor Anil Gupta, myself, and late President Mukherjee, honoring a young girl who had made science work for the poor. And that's why she got an award. We need to sort of create more such movements in India. And now, of course, they have started this Gandhian Young Technological Innovation Award. This is the 2018. You can see our president, our Minister of Science and Technology, and myself, along with the minister, the Professor Anil Gupta, and so on and so forth. So these are nationalized. I think the sense I'm trying to make is that Gandhian engineering, which was uttered in 2008, has become a big movement now, and it has become a kind of a national movement. And I'm very happy for it, because that's exactly what Gandhiji had said. The fruits of science must reach the poorest of the poor. I like to end again by looking at this rich man, very unfortunate, but he's using a $12,000 foot. Now, $12,000 cannot be an entire earning of one's lifetime for if you are poor. And that is where our $28 foot, Jaipur foot, made all the difference, you know. And it became sort of the cover page of Time magazine. It said the global source of landmines left thousands limbless, and then two gifted Indians developed a $28 foot. And you can quite clearly see this in action. Now watch it very carefully. This is that $28 foot. See the way he's climbing, right? See the flexibility in his foot, like a normal foot, okay? And now he will demonstrate to you the strength of the foot. Just jumps. It carries his entire weight with that impact, okay? And he's asked, does it hurt? And he said, not at all. It looks like a normal foot. And now what he does, you watch it carefully. This you will find absolutely incredible. He runs with that foot. And not only he runs, he can run a kilometer in 4 minutes, 30 seconds. Now, normally, if I was in your center, and if there was a crowd of 150 people, I would have asked, how many of you can run a kilometer in 4 minutes, 30 seconds? Hardly a hand goes up, by the way. Maybe two, three in 100. Now, let us say two hands go up in 100. What does that mean? That means the remaining 98, this person is able to beat. So we are, by making science work for the poor, we have given him life, we have given him livelihood, we have given him dignity, we have given him a way of life. Supposing that 12,000 foot was the dollar foot or the only one, he would still be crawling. He would not be running and beating 98 out of 100 of you. That is the importance of making science work for the poor. So I'd like to end because there are a lot of children here in a few minutes. Many people ask me, you're 78 now, you've learned a lot. Why don't you leave some lessons with us? So here are five Mashalkar mantras that I'd like to leave with you. The first is aspirations are your possibilities. Keep them high. But those aspirations should not just be for you, but also for our society, for our beloved nations. Why do we have to keep them high? Because if you aim at the Everest, then you can reach at least Kanchenjunga. But if you aim at Kanchenjunga, okay, you cannot even reach Hanuman Tekri. And how do you create those aspirations? You know, I became Fellow of Royal Society, which is considered as one of the highest honors after Nobel Prize. But the real prize is that you sign in the same book where Newton has signed. And by the way, there are only three engineering scientists who have been honored in the last 360 years with FRS. One is Professor Roddam Narasimhan, who passed away, as you know, a month ago. Second is my guru, Professor M.M. Sharma, who has already spoken at Nehru Science Center, as was told a little earlier. And third is myself. Now, supposing you start creating an aspiration in the following way, you know, when I was studying Newton's laws of motion, I never thought I will sign in the same book that Newton had signed. But supposing you create that aspiration while you are studying that you have to aim at signing in the book that Newton has signed, you can see what difference it is going to make. So keep them high. Second, particularly for the young of today, I want to say, like instant coffee, there is no instant success. But work hard in silence, let success make all the noise. And I always tell them that in my own life, I work day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, and I'll do so till the last day of my life. Next is purpose, perseverance, and passion. It is always too early to quit. Winners are never quitters, and quitters are never winners. So when you fail, we are bound to fail. So when you fail, look at fail as F-A-I-L, first attempt in learning. Your last mistake is your best guru, as long as you are able to learn from it. That's the fourth lesson that I've learned in my life. I've failed many times. Then when doors of opportunity that you keep on knocking don't open, create your own doors. I'll give you an example. I came back to India in 2006. India was a very poor country then. 1976. India was a very poor country. And today, children will not even understand that. Do you know, a telephone used to take 6 years. And when one got it, one would do puja and party. Now today, each one of you have a mobile. That was not the case. You know, mainframe computers were not available. 128K with great memory. I remember sharing this thing with Pune University. Now today, you carry gigaflops. Forget about KBS and MBPS and etc. Journals used to come by C-mail and so on and so forth. And the equipment that I wanted, Weisenberg Rheo-Ganimometer, to create a laboratory on rheology and non-neutral fluid mechanics, would come in 2 years. Digitally clearance, not manufactured in India certificate, no dollars, and so on and so forth. So I could not knock on that door of opportunity because that was locked with no foreign exchange and nothing. So I opened my node door. I went into modeling and simulation where I had to use only this. And can you believe me? In 1977, I started the work. In 5 years, in 82, I got the Bhatnagar Prize for the work that I did. What is the lesson? Supposing I had kept on knocking on that door and did not change my feet, waiting for 2 years for that equipment to come, I would not have won the Bhatnagar Prize. So you have to create your own doors. And the last point I'd like to end with my lecture with is there is no limit to human endurance, no achievement, imagination. So let me tell you what it means. You know, Professor C.N. Rao Bharat Ratna is the highest scientist in India today. Excepting for Nobel Prize, he has got everything, and I hope he gets it soon. I consider him as my guru. So when I became FRS, I phoned him up, sir, I've become FRS. I thought he would say great and celebrate, etc. Nothing. He said not bad. I was very disappointed. Then American Academy of Arts and Science, you know, from 1780, only 7 Indians had become. George, and it was created by Benjamin Franklin and George Washington, you know, in the year 1780. And 200 Nobel laureates are its fellows and whole range of things. I was only the 7th. So I called him. Again, he said, not bad. I was disappointed. And then came the next one. And the next one was National Academy of Inventors of US. And this time I was not 7th or 3rd or whatever. I was the 1st from India. Now I said, definitely we'll say. No, what was his response? Not bad. Then I got upset. I said, sir, what do I have to do to impress you? And what he said, I'm carrying that message for you. What he said is that, Mushankar, you are climbing on a ladder of excellence. And that ladder does not have limit. It's a limitless ladder of excellence. And the only limits are the limits that you put on your head, in your mind. And therefore, my mantra to you is that no matter what you achieve in life, you have to say my best is yet to come. And that's why I've said here, whether you are 18 or 80, when you get up in the morning, you should say my best is yet to come. And maybe today will be the day that it will come. Okay. And that will give you the energy to do your best and not just for yourself, but for our society and for our beloved nation. And if we all do that, take that oath on this great day, the Science Day, India will be a completely different nation, the new India of our dreams, among the top of the nations, not just in terms of wealth, in terms of values, and a real exemplar. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, sir. It was really a fascinating lecture, particularly because somehow, you know, every Indian, every child knows the value of science. They use the science and technology in everyday life. But when it comes to pursuing science or, you know, recognizing science, somehow, I don't know why, it takes a backseat. And science also is considered as something elite. I don't know why that elitist tag has been attached to science. So by your lecture, I think you made it very amply clear that the perception of science is for the elitist has been completely debunked. And the way it has really impacted the lives of people, you know, hogging the headlines of Time magazine for $28 the per foot is something which I hope our youngsters, our students who have for listening to your lecture. We'll take take your advice and hope to tread the path that you have been choosing, and ensuring that there is a limitless ladder which you talked about, which Professor C.N.R. Rao spoke to you, and hope that they will continue to tread this limitless ladder. Sir, maybe we'll take some questions. Any of you inside the Zoom platform would like to ask question to Professor Mashalkar, sir? Or maybe Umesh, you can also see the, because I don't have YouTube and Facebook. Ramchandran, you want to ask a question? Sir, Ramchandran is the director of the Birla Industrial Technological Museum. He has logged in from Calcutta, I think. Yeah.
From sir, I would like to know this tablet you told, low cost tablet, it's fantastic. I also get it. But what is the reason for its failure? Why we could not give it to the children? We have lost so many children. It should have been avoided. What do you feel, sir?
It is the failure not of the people who created it. It's the failure of the government. As I said, what happens is that there is what is called as a talent, technology, and trust. We have all the talent. We have the technology. As you can say, Simputer, that fellow says, is ahead of the rest of the world, right?
Yeah.
But what is done now in most governments is that when you have something like this, government becomes the first buyer.
Okay.
And supposing on Simputer there was an order of 10,000 that was placed. Okay. Then he has a chance to create 10,000. All right.
Okay.
Bring down the cost, and then it goes to the users. Then the users, based on what they do, they give a feedback. Based on that, we improve the design and make it workable. And then it becomes productionized. And then it enters the market. So there is a big gap. You understand? Like, for example, I'll give you an example. When I was the Director General of CSIR, I created New Millennium Indian Technology Leadership Initiative. The key word was leadership, because we have been followers. There is rarely anything where India is the first one to do that.
Okay.
Everybody does it, and then sort of we follow. Like somebody opens the new window, like let's say Bednarz Müller, created these transition metal oxide based superconductors. As soon as they did that, we wrote 3,000 papers. But we are not the first one to do that. You get that? Okay. So I said leadership, where we do the first thing. Then we have to take risk, because leadership means we are bound to follow. Because if you are following somebody, you are playing safe. So I said we'll have that. And that was the grand challenge. The grand challenge was, I looked at India's problems. So at that time, year 2000, I'm talking about 21 years ago, I created this and I said $2,000 was the laptop cost. I said, make it $200. I'm a 10x guy, 10 times better, 10 times cheaper. That's what India should be doing. And Vinay Kulkarni came up with that you saw actually being sort of.
Yeah.
But then there was a struggle, because then somebody has to manufacture, somebody has to place an order, etc., etc. You never know. And then finally, some high net worth individual in Pune paid, I think, 3 crore or 4 crore, something like that, bought over all the technology, and he produces some 10,000. Oh. It should have been 10 million.
Correct.
You get the point. So yes. What is happening is that we are creating these now public procurement policies where we give a chance to these people. You know, for example, let me tell you, in Maharashtra state, there is a Master State Innovation Society. Okay. I am the co-chairman. The Minister of Skill Development, Entrepreneurship, and myself, we co-chair that meeting. Now, we have created a startup policy where, for startups, for example, you have to give them a this thing, you know, like, for example, Sachin Tendulkar. Mm-hmm. At the age of 15, he scored a century, right? But supposing we say, where is your 10 years experience before you get to test? So startups are like that. Those startups are startups. You can't ask them for 10-year experience. They can't compete. So what we have done in Maharashtra state is that no experience. And we have changed the entire tender process. I'll give you an example. There is somebody, a startup who created drones. And those drones normally fly in air. These are drones which can walk on water or move on water.
Okay.
So after Ganesh Chaturthi, as you know, in a lot of immersion and so on and so forth, the rivers get spoiled. Now, this drone is able to clear all that where human cannot go. So what we did was that we did not put a competitive bid. We straight away gave the contract to him. He proved it. And now he has got intensities.
Oh, great.
You understand the point.
So yeah.
But the missing policies, I think we need to bring them up. And I'm very happy that this government is trying to do that.
Thank you.
So there is one question. I don't know whether she's a student. Archana Deshpande.
Yeah.
It's in the social media. Which labs are open for us to develop healthcare devices? You know, some of the healthcare devices like the ECG that you showed, sir. Perhaps she is asking about that. Are there any labs which are open for them to approach?
Of course. I think you have the CSIR labs, ICMR labs. You know, CSIR has 38 labs, out of which 9 are in that particular field. ICMR, practically all the labs are there. And the government is now creating incubators. You know, the Atal Innovation Movement that has started, as a matter of fact, there are incubators practically, as you would know, practically in all schools and so on and so forth, where you can experiment. Similarly, Department of Biotechnology under BIRAC program, they have partnered with, Srishti, Professor Anil Gupta's, and Honeybee Network. And they have created facilities now, where they support, incubate, and other things, etc. So there are lots of these. I think they should go get onto the website of many of the government agencies, whether it is CSIR, ICMR, Department of Biotechnology, Department of Science and Technology. This government is doing quite a lot, just like the previous governments did. All governments have done. It's an issue of now more aggressive policies to support. That's the most important.
There is one, Bonika Damodar, she's asking, sir, how we can improve water scarcity problem in the rural areas and how we can resolve the dumping ground problem?
Well, it is all in your hands. It is a social behavior problem. It's a human behavior problem. Many of the problems are created by ourselves, by the way. Otherwise, why should Cherrapunji have record rainfall in a year and yet in summer they would be striving for water? I think it is all created bias. We have to create those systems of storage, recycling, refilling, and careful use.
Scientists from inside, anyone of you would like to ask questions, please?
Hello.
Yeah. Sunanda Jadhav, yeah.
Hello, sir. Myself, Dr. Sunanda Jadhav. Very good morning, Dr. Mashelkar and all the team. I just wanted to ask, how can we motivate all our school students to get more into research and doing low-cost research project for the society?
Well, I think you should show them Mashelkar lecture. My lecture today shows how the benefit of using high technology for the poor can help the poor, because they must have seen people dying out of cancer, people dying out of anemia, people dying out of this, that, and the other. The question is, how do you save them if you can't give them anything affordable? So that is the noble cause. And science is not just for the elite, but is also for solving the problem of the poor. And they will enjoy doing it. You know, it is like this. The training we have to give them, very frankly, is that never be a part of a problem. Be a part of a solution. Mm-hmm. And that solution you have to create.
Yes.
Our training has to be different. You see, this is the challenge, actually. Because what kills us is learning by rote. From there, we have to come to learning by doing. But not doing what the teacher says, but learning by creating what you think. And learning by co-creating, working with not man versus machine, man and machine. That's the first part. The second part is that our education system is based on single correct answer.
Yes.
You have to tell them there is no single correct answer. Excepting, of course, you can't change Newton's first law, second law, or Avogadro number. That is a different matter.
Definitely.
One problem. For example, I do a experiment when I interact with children. You know what is that experiment? You should do that too.
Yes, please.
I take a half a glass of water, glass, in which there is half filled water. And I say, how would you take it out? And I go around. First says, pour it. The second says, break the glass. Destructive innovation. Third says, take a straw and sip it out.
Yes.
Still put it in the sun. Evaporation.
Evaporation, right.
Remembers the story of the crow. Stones.
Mm-hmm. Stones.
You remember?
Crow, yeah.
So, yeah. And after 7 or 8, it stops. I show them 41 ways of doing it. Do we teach 41 ways of doing it in schools? No. There is single correct answer. So that attitude has to change. Secondly, be a part of a solution. Like I showed the children, I just showed one figure. But let me give you two examples. Under National Innovation Foundation, we give awards, which are given by the President of India, by the way. I've been his president for 18 years now. Chairman, and I just resigned, retired just 2 years ago. Now, there is this girl, Ramya, born in a poor family. Her father has cancer. Her mother is perennially ill. She has to take 3 buses to go to school and come home. And when she comes home, she has to wash clothes. It is her duty. So when will she study? She either can wash clothes or she will study. What did she do? She did innovation. What are the innovation? A pedal-driven washing machine. So a rotating drum, and which can be pedaled. So while she is reading, she is doing that. Can you just imagine? Another girl, Shalini, 13-year-old girl from Bihar. She saw her grandfather walking up the steps, but with her father walking up the steps at great difficulty with the walker, because they would not go on the steps. So she created 2 spring-loaded front end sort of a walker. And we helped her to design it. We helped her to sort of, and so on. Today, that walker, which can walk on the steps, as a matter of fact, 10,000 of it is produced per year. There's a manufacturing license she has given, 13-year-old at that time. Now she's 18, 5 years ago. And she gets royalties which are higher than her father's income. Can you just imagine that? Why? So when I talk about Ramya and Shalini, Ramya saw the problem, I have to wash or study. She said, no, I will do both. Here, Shalini saw her grandfather having that particular problem. She said, all right, what can we do? Old age and we have nothing. She solved the problem. So my answer to you is make them creative, innovative, by taking a problem at hand and creating multiple solutions. All right, that will do the magic.
Maybe one or two more questions. There's one insight. What if someone doesn't have such high knowledge for how to create devices for help, but they have the wish to do so, then is there any institute or a body which can aid them?
No. I think that you have to look at entire India as a laboratory, by the way. Please don't look for one institute here and there, etc. That's what I said. No democratization of innovation. Absolutely. Everyone is someone, basically. There will be always somebody to sort of give that knowledge. Our problem is that we always look at one institute. They are supposed to do that. It's a country of a billion. We are billion institutes.
Any other?
There was one, sir. There's one question. How to approach government if somebody makes to purchase a first 1,000 devices or so, a low cost one?
Sorry, I didn't get the question.
So, sir, I think the question is, suppose if somebody invents and then how do you approach the government to purchase, acquire thousands of them to scale up?
Now there is a policy that has come up. No, when our Prime Minister created the startup policy, he made life easy for startups. For example, patenting, it was very expensive. Now the government takes care of 80% of the expenses, or it was difficult to get one. They are moving through a sort of a green channel. And the initial help that I talked about, like the drone example I gave, no, that there are states now. Kerala state has a fantastic policy, for example, in terms of helping in terms of their new purchase policies. Maharashtra state has, other states are coming, Gujarat, and so many states are coming now. Each state, by the way, has an innovation council now. All right? It's not just the nation, because things have to happen at a ground level. And that cannot happen until at a state level things start happening. So this is actually happening now.
Any other questions, Umesh? Because
I think we are random.
Jayaraman, sir, you want Dr. Jayaraman? So he's a nuclear scientist from DRC.
Oh.
No, you're muted, sir. You're muted.
Thank you, sir, for that brilliant and scintillating exposition of your life experience. As the most revered pragarya of innovation in the world, I'd like to know what is this simple linear equation between science, technology, and innovation. We have more science, will we have more technology? Will more technology will give us innovation? There seems to be a complex relationship between these three parameters. I would like to have your authentic opinion on this, sir. Oh,
that's an excellent question. You know, because idea to impact is a long journey. You may have an idea, but then how do you convert that idea into something that will impact the society? And that's a very tough journey, by the way. And that requires perseverance, that requires passion, that requires support from the society and so on and so forth, that never give up attitude, even when you fail, you know, the patience, as I said, fail is the first attempt in learning, etc. So your mental attributes matter. It is not just the resource, because many times people feel that for great ideas, you require great money. That is not the case. I mean, we have seen brilliant examples. I mean, if you look at the 1920, that was a magical year for Indian science. If you look at Sir J.C. Bose, S.N. Bose, C.V. Raman, Ramanujan, and all those people, basically, what money did they have? They did not have any money. So it is the power of the ideas that matters. It is not the power of the budget. So first of all, the most important part is to get ideas which are breakthrough, which can be impactful. Second is to give support to those ideas. Because anytime you are talking about a disruptive idea, basically, first thing people ask is that has somebody done it? You get the point. So changing that mindset becomes important. And we have to understand the human capacity. I remember when I became the director of National Chemical Laboratory, 1989, we were 2 years before liberalization, we were just doing import substitution. All right? We are copying, we are reverse engineering. So anytime we did something which was ahead of the rest of the world, you know, and I went to the industry, they would say, but have they done it? That has US done it? Has Europe done it? Has Japan done it? If not, how can? So I said, come on. This is not on. Because then we'll remain a copying country. So I said, I'm selling knowledge, I will sell it across the world and to the biggest companies in the world. And I remember my own area is polymers, and in solid state polycondensation, we created not just papers, but patents, basically. And we licensed three of them in 1992 for close to $1 million for General Electric in an area where they were the leaders. 40% of polycarbonate they were producing in the world. They were the world leaders. And our superior ideas, which are converted into patents, actually we could license to them. So I think the first is self-belief. When we say Atmanirbhar Bharat, it has to be Atmanirbhar Bharat with Atmavishwas, self-confidence. Okay? And with that self-confidence, you have to move. And then secondly, you have to trust the sort of creator. Otherwise, it cannot go to marketplace. I'll give you an example. Like I showed this fellow, Naveen Khanna. Dengue, 15-minute test, right? You know what is the story? That's why I say talent, technology, and trust. What is most important to answer your question, how do you move from idea to marketplace, is you have to have a combination of talent, technology, and trust. You may have talent, like Naveen Khanna had. You may have technology. He had a breakthrough on that this thing. But if you don't have trust, you won't move. So in his case, what happened? He created the dengue kit, which was far better than anybody else. But we were importing from South Korea. We were importing from Australia. We were importing from America. Nobody would take his technology. Then what happened was that there was a pandemic. And all the kits were getting exhausted. The government had no option but to order them, bulk order. But in a short time. Australia said, we can't supply in short time. US said, we can't supply in short time. South Korea said, we can. And what happened by luck was those kits, you know, they were loaded on the wrong ship. So they went to Africa rather than coming to India. So what happened, Professor Jayaraman, is that we did not have any kits. So we had no option but to go for Naveen Khanna's kit. And Naveen Khanna, we had 0% market share, is today 78%. But supposing that ship had come, then what would happen? He should be still 0%. So answer to your question is that we have the talent, we have technology, we have to trust. Trust is the most important. If that happens, then India will conquer. As simple.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So in fact, sir has just left a international conference, I think. The External Affairs Ministry is also there and come here for just 1 hour. So we have taken more than 1 hour. May I now request Umesh to conclude this because sir has to go back to attend that function.
In fact, justifying whatever was told by Dr. Mashilkar means that inside the lecture means more from less for more. In fact, he has shown that in time also. I think within that time, we were going very well and has given a lot more things to us, which we are going to share on Facebook as well as YouTube. Perhaps more and more people will see and they will get inspired. Really, truly professional and inspirational, motivational. I think all words will be less if I'll say. I'll just say thank you very much, sir, for accepting our invitation and giving a wonderful lecture. We'll bother you once again, maybe again and again, whenever we'll get the time and you will have time. Thank you very much, sir. And thanks to all our audience and our guests who have joined us for this.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, sir. It's an honor, sir.
Thank you.